So we have seen a lot of searching and sorting algorithms abstractly. So let's try and understand in a more concrete setting how the claims that we made about their complexity actually work. So here are some experiments that we will run. So we will start, remember in the beginning we talked about this timer class which will be used to measure time. So this is just the same class, so it's called timer error. So remember it allows us to start a timer and to stop a timer, right? So that's basically we will use this to show in physical time how much time execution takes. So the first thing that we were looking at was searching a list. So we had two strategies, right? So we had this naive search. So naive search basically was one thing which just scanned through the entire list, and whenever it found the item it would return true, otherwise it would eventually come out from the list saying that the item is not there and return false. So the worst case is when the item is missing. And then we had binary search, which would basically divide the interval into two and search either the first half or the second half if it did not find it, right? So let's just check that these two implementations are correct by looking at some trivial example. So we just set up a list here which is a list of all the even numbers from 0 to 50, right? So now I search then for all the numbers from 0 to 50. So it should say that all the even numbers are found and all the odd numbers are not found, which is indeed the case. So for 0, naive search. So the first line is naive search, second line is binary search. So 0, 2, 4, 6, 8 are true, 1, 3, 5, 7 are false. So this is just to convince myself that I have not made any silly mistake in writing those two functions. So now what I really want to do is compare the performance of these two algorithms. So one way to compare it is to run it on large inputs and also to run it multiple times. So just for the interest of making sure that this does not take too long, I am going to run 10 to the power 4 worst case searches in a list of the size 10 to the power 5. So what is a worst case search? It is going to be a search which is not going to work. So here I am going to take 10 to the power 5. So I am taking, notice here 10 to the power 5. I am taking all the even numbers between 0 and 10 to the power 5. So this is actually half of 10 to the power 5, right? And then I am going to take a bunch of odd numbers, 1000 odd numbers from 3000 to 13000, and I am going to search for them in this list, right? And for every such thing I am going to start a timer, then search and then stop it and then print the timer. So first I will do it for naive search and then I will do it for binary search, right? So let us run this thing. So it takes some amount of time. So naive search for this takes 10.6 seconds and binary search takes less than 1 second. So there is a factor of 10 speed up. It should possibly be more dramatic than this, but at least it is clear that binary search is much better than naive search, right? So we will come back to this issue about why binary search is not as good as it seems, right, compared to naive search, but naive search is certainly worse. So the next thing we looked at was some naive sorting algorithms. So the first naive sorting algorithm was selection sort. So this is an implementation of selection sort. So remember in selection sort, say we are doing it in ascending order, we find the minimum element and move it to the beginning, right? So we assume that we have sorted up to position I minus 1. We take the value at I onwards, find the minimum and put it at position I, right? So this is selection sort. So the scanning and finding the minimum is not going to change whether or not that suffix of the list or sequence is sorted or not. So whether it is in random order or ascending order or so on does not matter. So let us set up an experiment with that, right? So what we do is we take 5000 elements, right, and we create 5000 random elements. So we start with a random library of Python, okay, and what this says is it creates for I in range 5000. So it creates 5000 random elements between 0 and 10 to the power 5, right? So I am basically creating a random list of size 5000, and then I am creating an ascending list of 5000, which is 0 to 4999, and then I am creating a descending list of 5000, which is 4999 to 0, right? So I create these three lists and I put each of them in a dictionary called input lists with the key random, ascending and descending, right? And now what I do is I put this whole thing in a loop. So I have this timer which I create, and then for each of these random, ascending, descending, right, I first make a copy of the list. I do not want to change it. Remember that these are in place sorts, so I just take a slice, right, and then I start it, the timer, run the selection sort on this list that I am passing it, stop it and print it, right. So, if I run this, then you will see that I have chosen the numbers to run this fast. So, each of them takes about a second, but they take the same amount of time. This is the important thing, right. So, if it is random or ascending or descending, it does not matter. They all take roughly, as you can see, 1.2 seconds or so, okay. Now, here is a insertion sort, which was another naive sort that we looked at, right. And in insertion sort, we said that the performance actually should vary according to whether it is ascending or not. So, if we run insertion sort on the same thing, we would expect that it will work better on the sorted arrays than on the unsorted arrays. So, indeed, if I run insertion sort on the same random elements, right, on the random elements it actually takes a little longer than selection sort. There it took 1.2 seconds, here it is taking 2 seconds. But on ascending order it takes a fraction of a second, right, because in ascending order the insert operation is trivial. Right, and in descending order it is taking something like 5 seconds. So, it is actually much worse, because in descending order essentially whenever we are taking the minimum element we have to insert it all the way to the back, because each element that we see is smaller than everything before it. So, we have to do the maximum number of inserts. Now, what about a recursive insertion sort, right. So, a recursive insertion sort now will, if we run it on the same inputs, we first see something interesting, right, which is that we will get an error which is because of something called the recursion depth, right. So, you may have seen this before in the Python course, but Python by default has a very small tolerance for recursion because it is worried that you are out of control. So, typically the recursion depth is, so you can have about 1000 nested calls, which is not enough for insertion sorting say an ascending or descending order list where it has to keep doing something for say 5000 elements. So, one way to fix that is to set this thing called the recursion limit, and it turns out that the largest value you are allowed to set in Python is this number 2 to the power 31 minus 1. So, you can do this thing of setting the recursion limit by importing this system library and calling it with this number. So, once we do this, right, then we can run our insertion sort as before, and now I am running it on even smaller lists, right. So, there initially I was running it on a 5000 size list, now I am running it on a 2000 size list, which is only 40%. If you remember, insertion sort on the iterative version took 2 seconds, now here on something which is much smaller it is taking 12 seconds, right. And there if you remember the insertion sort on the sorted version took really a very small amount, like 1/10,000th of a second, and here it is taking almost 1/10th of a second. So, what this is saying is that although they are equivalent as algorithms, the recursion basically makes the whole thing much slower, because every time you have to call and return from a function there is an extra cost involved. So, our basic counting is not working as well when we have to deal with these function calls. And finally, we have merge sort. Right. So, we have this merge function, and then we have merge sort which calls this merge function, and we said that merge sort is an order n log n sort, so it should work much better on even large inputs. So, again we can run it on a trivial thing, so we just take sorting the even numbers from 0 to 1000 followed by the odd numbers from 0. So, we construct a list which is 0 to 4 followed by 1357, and we sort it, and indeed merge sort produces a sorted output. But our real interest is in the performance. So, supposing now we take a seriously large array which we have not tried at all with insertion sort and selection sort. If you try it, you will find it takes forever. But 10 to the power 6, remember if I do n log n on 10 to the power 6, log n of 10 to the power 3 is about 10. So, n log n on 10 to the power 6 is going to be more than 10 to the power 7. And we said that 10 to the power 7 is what we would expect in 1 second. So, n log n should take between 1 second and 10 seconds is what we would estimate. So, if we run this again on our 3 types of inputs, random, ascending and descending, but this time the numbers are 10 to the power 6 and not those 5000 which we were doing with insertion sort, then you will find that indeed the random one takes little less than 10 seconds and the ascending and descending will take about half the time, right. So, this shows that merge sort is indeed significantly faster than the naive sorts working in n log n time.